when you trade somebody, you if you get what you want right now, but you give them 2, 3, 4 years to use it, the longer they use it, they take to use it, it's like giving you an interest-free loan. More importantly, the longer they have to use it, the more unlikely they'll use all of it, and that gives you a discount. What is the marginal net worth of your client prospect worth to somebody else? What would your client be worth to somebody else? Because maybe your product could be a lead for them, and they give you all the money because they want to get more, they want a stimulus to get more prospects, more buyers. And now that you've got this mindset, you know how to, as a visionary leader and a strategic conceptualist, you know how to do it for them. What are your highest margin products and services? What are your highest repeat purchase products and services? When you know those, you know how much you can give away or share and profitable. If you got something that's 3 times more profitable, you can give a lot away to the partner for starting to get your buyers in that. But you don't know that until you look at those questions. What logical products can be created by you, acquired by you, and adapted or adopted, modified, that exist in the market? What markets could your products or services also apply to or translate to that they're not in right now? What related fields could you penetrate? What parallel universes are most similar to yours? What other industries, what other fields, what other kinds of businesses are like yours but not really the same but a great source of access? What other business market products or services have you been thinking about? Look for additional alliances or markets where you can take on their products or services and sell them through your business, where you can provide services or functions to them, where you can share personnel or facilities, where you can sell equity or buy equity, where you can develop referral alliance feeder programs. Finding the correct partner. Who else has direct access to the markets, the buying influences, the individuals, the companies, the media, the distribution channels, the prospects, the research and data, the technology methodology you want or need? And list, as you're building this out, list the type of business generically, the kind of influence you need to talk to there to make a deal, with the decision maker, what they reach, who they reach that you want to reach, and who the decision maker is. Then you go back and you look up the businesses in this industry and you find the name of the decision maker and you test out presentations, letters, approaches to get them to do deals with you. Strengths and weaknesses of target organizations, prime assets. When you're looking for partners, you want to know what's their strength, what's their weakness, what are their prime assets, what is their attitude, what are their key important points of impact they bring you to the market, what's their purpose, what do they have you could reclaim, old buyers that don't buy anymore, prospects that don't do anything anymore. We used to go to magazines and get all their old articles and get reprints that we could use to send to our prospects and clients, and it looked like the magazines were endorsing us. The best partners will have what you don't have, and they'll be strong where you are weak. Match your company's capabilities with people who share your objectives. You want values that are similar. Look for companies to partner with who are one step ahead of other competitors. That's good, but sometimes you want them one step behind because they still have a database or access that you can very quickly and ethically but opportunistically really capitalize on for a windfall short-term profit. Large companies can make good partners. Who else has a sales force you can tap into? Who sells to the same demographic profile you want to reach? Who has the trust, respect, and goodwill of your prospective market? Who has authored a book that's respected in your field that you can get them to lend their name to you? Who is not a direct competitor but accesses my market? Why, when, how should an alliance with suppliers be considered? Alliance with suppliers are when the supplier can give you more favorable access. Terms, financing, development, advanced access, then it's really worth it. When you're working together to create new products and develop them. What could competitors offer to your market that you don't? That's finding ones that you can bring in. Remember I told you that a lot of people have prospects they don't sell. A lot of people sell only one part of the package of goods you do. A lot of people basically give up prematurely. Who are the industry gurus your market follows that you might be able to get to endorse you? Who are the weaker but quality competitors you might buy? List your possible risks and fears in working with them. List their possible risks and fears in working with you. How can you actually verbally and transactionally overcome them and take away the risk for them to want to do things with you? How many other ways can you help other people optimize or monetize their sales, reclaim their sales, utilize their distribution or their buyer base or their services better? Okay. What do you think, Spike? Done. Okay. The last thing we're going to talk about before we build your template is barter. Exchanging goods or services for product services that you would normally have to write a check for. In the course of my career, I've probably either been directly or indirectly or associated with people who've done $500 million worth of no cash barter. They've used it to get advertising, they've used it to create profit centers, they've used it to reduce expenses, they've used it to monetize dead inventory, they've used it to gain competitive advantage. I'm just going to give you the first level of understanding and education for two reasons. Whether you do it or not, it's an incredible exercise in creative thinking. And creative thinking is part of the innovative, strategic breakthrough process. Okay. With barter, you can create virtually unlimited buying power at will. I should tell you, Spike was the CEO of our country's largest publicly owned barter exchange. So he knows barter better than I do. You can enjoy up to 80% cash savings on a surprising number of your business and personal purchases and expenses. You could acquire needed items using money you've already spent. You can finance major financial purchases interest-free for up to 2 years and get the seller to actually discount the purchase for the longer it takes you to pay. Sounds wild, but if I trade you my consulting for, let's say, your car, and you give me your car right now, and I say you can have a year to use my consulting. Let's say your car is worth $500,000. It's an expensive one. I give you $500,000 credit for my consulting. I get your car right now. No money changed hands. If you wait let's say I give you 5 years to use my consulting, let's make it better. The price I charge today is going to be higher than the price I would charge, later. So $50,000 is the cost today. In 5 years, it might be $100,000 because of inflation. And if you don't use all your credit today, if you use it in 5 years, it's going to be worth only half. I'm not trying to take advantage of you. It's just that I get the advantage. Many people in barter don't use everything, and that discounts it more. It's an incredible profit center if you use it right. You can make middleman profits up to 300% without investing a dime of your own money or committing yourself into any liability just by recognizing and gaining control. We're going to give you 15 simple barter strategies to consider that people do, just so you can get a taste, a flavor, and your creative thinking takes off. I don't care whether you do it or not. It's just very fun to know about. One, you can save cash on capital expenditures. You can make a list of almost everything you would normally buy in your business life and in your personal life. Then, as long as whatever product or service you sell has good margin and it can be replaced, let's say your margin is 40%. Well, anything you would buy for cash, if you could trade it at full retail or full market value for your product, you just got a 40% savings. Does that make sense? Like that. More interestingly, in barter, certain hard goods like cars or TVs or electronics are worth twice as much as soft goods. So you can get even a multiple on what it would give you if you wrote a check for cash. You can increase your total sales. If right now you're producing 80% capacity, but if you traded goods and services you could produce for products and services you wanted, and you went to full capacity, your margins would go up across the board, and you'd still save money also on the products or services you were acquiring at a discount. Barter lets you pay operating expenses, even payroll, with soft dollars. You can use resources, service providers, painters, everything. And instead of paying them with checks, you could say, hey, I'll give you carpet from my store, or I'll give you use of my rental car for a month, or I'll give you electrical services at your painting offices. And all of a sudden, you've accomplished what you don't want or maybe can't afford to write a check for, but you've got it with something that you can produce whenever you want for a very, very, very low amount less. You can print your own currency and actually become a bank. It's called script, which is only usable at you. You can write and say, here's a voucher due you for $10,000 of my carpet. What I want for you is for you to provide me with $10,000 of your restaurant credits that I can use for my sales force and my convention. Well, you just gave carpet that probably sells for a dollar but cost you 20 cents, and you got $10,000 worth of restaurant credit that if you were to go to the restaurant and pay them, you'd have to write real cash checks for. Does that make sense? Automatically get terms, credit, and discounts far more easily than you could pay in cash. You go to somebody to buy something, normally they want a check right now. You go to a bank to borrow money, they want interest, and they want a certain amount of terms. When you trade somebody, if you get what you want right now, but you give them 2, 3, 4 years to use it, the longer they use it, they take to use it, it's like giving you an interest-free loan. More importantly, the longer they have to use it, the more unlikely they'll use all of it, and that gives you a discount. Finally, if they use all of it, the more unlikely they'll just use all of it, they'll use more than all of it, and that gives you cash transactions. Does that make sense? Elaine, do you get that? Yes? Okay. Breakage, we already talked about that. Cash conversion. You can do barter a number of ways. One is direct for things you want or need in your business or outside. Number two, you can do triangulation, which means you take what you've got, which maybe isn't appealing to the people who have what you want, and you trade it to a third party for something that is appealing to the people you're trying to trade with. That's called triangulation. The third approach is a barter profit center. And I'll tell you a story that should hopefully make a point. One of my many jobs before I became a marketing expert was working for a magazine in Indiana. The magazine was a travel magazine, but it was the number three successful one. It wasn't one, it wasn't two. It was very, very low on success rate. We had great difficulty selling advertising pages to people. However, many advertisers were willing to trade. Hotels would trade credit for rooms and food. Airlines would trade credit for travel, airfare. Electronics makers would trade TVs or stereos. But we didn't know what to do. They didn't. Then I came there, and we changed our strategy. Now, one other thing. Ad pages in our magazine were selling at retail for $10,000 a piece. Our hard cost was only $1,000 a piece. So we were getting a 10 times markup. Are you all with me? But we couldn't sell many because we were the number three in the market. But we could trade, but we didn't know what to do with it. So here's what I did. I started aggressively trading to hotels, to airlines, to resorts, to electronics people for goods and services at retail value, $10,000 of our advertising, one page for $10,000 in TVs or $10,000 in hotel credit or $10,000 of restaurant credit. Then I would take the credit and instantly sell it to somebody who I'd strategically realized wanted it or needed it or could benefit from it for 50% off, half off, 50 cents on the dollar. Now, remember, the pages were selling for $10,000 on the few, but we were having trouble selling them. They were costing us 1,000, 10 to 1. We were not selling much, we were getting no cash in. But when I traded a $10,000 page for $10,000 worth of electronics or stereos or TVs that I sold for $5,000 that I sold for cash. We got cash in our bank account for $5,000. I was getting $5,000 for something that cost us $1,000. So I still was making 500% on my money. I have created profit, barter profit centers for companies all over the world. Car dealers are perfect for it. Big car dealer in the States may do $150 million in sales. That means they probably have $10 to $20 million in expenses. Everything from car wash people to paint and carpet and you know, sign painters and janitorial. Well, if they can trade a car that they have 20% margin in for something they were going to buy for cash, they just reduced it by 20%. And on $20 million worth of expenses, that just brought $4 million to their bottom line. But it gets better. We even get car dealers to trade the use of a car for 4 years, like a lease, and fully value it and take it back at the end and get the reclamation value. Is that too sophisticated or does it make sense? You all get it? Isn't that interesting? Should be exciting creatively. Create a barter profit center. We just talked about that. Home shopping network. In the States, I don't know about here, there's a big 24-hour-a-day cable network that's all about shopping. They just sell stuff. The way it got started is a man owned this very unsuccessful radio station in Florida. He couldn't sell advertising, so he traded for anything he could get and tried to sell it. One time, he got stuck trading for 1,000 electric can openers, and he didn't know what to do with them, so he did a special Saturday 4-hour auction of all the junk that he'd collected and trade, and he sold everything out, and it gave him the idea of having a shopping channel. But he started by doing that to grow his business, and he kept expanding and expanding. Vastly expand your available advertising budget without using any cash. In the United States, one of the most successful cruise lines is called Carnival Cruise. Carnival started out with a secondhand beat-up one cruise ship. They were so poor, they could only paint it on one side. Truthfully, the other side was all rusted and ugly. They had to back it in always to the port with the painted side out so that travelers would see it. They had no money, and they had about 800 rooms on a typical boat when it went out. They were only selling about 400. So every time they'd go out every week, 400 rooms were unfilled. The rooms were worth $1,000 a week. That means they were losing $400,000 a week, no pun intended, down the drain. They went to a friend of mine named Dave Wagenford and said, can you trade it for advertising to sell paid travelers and cruise packages. He went to radio stations, television stations, magazines, people like us, Holiday Magazine, and he traded advertising for the cruise line for credits that the advertisers could use later for cruises. The advertisers used the credits to either reward their advertisers, reward their employees, do contests for their readers or listeners or viewers. Very powerful. Carnival got $100 million worth of advertising in the first 2 years for almost no out-of-pocket expense. You can finance rapid growth without cash. You can just use barter when you don't have any more capital, when you don't have any more resources. You can use it to create growth, financial capacity at will. You can instantly and continuously generate a steady stream of profits at far above closeout prices. Let's say you got products or raw goods or anything that you know, they're dead inventory. Well, normally you'd sell it for 50, 60, 80% off. Now, instead of taking a loss on it and getting this much, you can trade it for full rate. If it's hard goods, you may even trade it for double. And you can convert that, or you can trade it for something you'd normally buy, so you get a great savings instead of a loss. You can turn excess inventory into cash without losing regular business. When you trade something, you trade with people who don't currently do business with you now. That's a stipulation. That means it's incremental business, and it also means after the trading transaction is over, if they have a good experience with you, they will become cash clients. Great example. DHL is out here, isn't it? DHL, the delivery service. When they came to the United States, they didn't have a lot of marketing money. They went to the same friend of mine, Dave Wagenford, and he traded $6 million worth of their package delivery to radio stations, television stations, publications, who previously were using Federal Express and paying cash. So all of a sudden, DHL got advertising that made their brand popular in the United States, but DHL also got access to thousands of advertisers who started using their package goods on trade. But when the trade ran out, guess what? They had a relationship, they trusted them, they converted to cash buyers. Does that make sense? Recycle dollars right back into your own pockets. In California, there's a resort city called Palm Springs. Palm Springs is a vacation and tourist location. They have a Palm Springs, what is it? Not the Advertising Bureau, what Business Association Bureau. My brain is a little muddled. And there's like 100 businesses that each pay into a fund that is used to run ads all over the country to inspire and persuade people in New York and Indiana to come to Palm Springs on vacation. But they're very smart. They will buy advertising with a magazine. They will buy advertising with a television station. They will buy advertising with a newspaper anywhere in the country. But they stipulate that the payment has to be spent back with their members. That means, let's say they buy $100,000 worth of advertising on a major television station. Well, they'll give the station a credit that station can use with any of the 100 Palm Springs merchants, but the money comes back to the merchants. Do you understand that? It doesn't leave Palm Springs and go to New York or go to Chicago. It stays in Palm Springs and reinvests back to the merchants. You can give your stockholders or stakeholders or vendors great benefits to reward them, acknowledge them, enrich them, you know, bond get greater to them.